Good morning. I feel like I'm out in a high school auditorium. I'll say it again. Good morning. All right. Might have been better than a high school auditorium. Welcome to the final day of the summit, which I'm sure each one of you would agree has been incredible. And a reminder of all the great work that's happening and all the great work that is ahead of each one of us. This morning, it is my privilege to introduce two amazing gentlemen who, in my opinion, are game-changing public education today. I'm proud to introduce them because they represent the personalized, anytime, anywhere learning that is driving achievement in so many places across this country. First, David Coleman is president of the College Board, which oversees the Advanced Placement Program, as well as the newly redesigned SAT. And in my position in New Mexico as the Secretary of Education, I can say that we offer the PSAT to every single 10th grader in our state, and we have doubled the numbers of AP students in just a couple of years. So proud, proud participants. He has long been a proponent of higher academic standards, and in 2013, he was on Time Magazine's list of the 100 most influential people in the world. Under his leadership, the College Board has embraced the mission of putting college in reach for more low-income students, increasing access to AP classes, free online tutorials for the SAT through the Khan Academy, and customizing support for students in the college application process. Speaking of the Khan Academy, we are also joined today by its founder, Sal Khan. In 2004, he began tutoring his cousin online in math. Let's just say some of those lessons went a little viral. Just a little. And the Khan Academy went global. Khan Academy lessons now cover the gamut of subject areas at all grade levels. They have been viewed by more than 500 million times and have been embraced by teachers in classrooms across the country and the world. Sal's mission statement is simple: to provide a world-class education for anyone, anywhere. And to honor that commitment, there has never been a charge for any of the lessons. Sal was a pioneer in demonstrating the power of digital technology to rethink how we deliver education in the 21st century. Because of that, in 2012, he also made the Times list of the world's most influential people. And as I said, in my home state of New Mexico, we have an incredible partnership between the College Board and Khan Academy, serving every single student, and we are excited to continue to be a part of their mission to serve students. I'm gonna go off script. For those of you who know me, I do that occasionally. It is really my privilege to introduce these amazing gentlemen, David Coleman and Sal Khan, because not only are they game-changing this world, but I've gotten to know each one of them just a little bit. And if I had the opportunity to write their bio in three words or less, I would say that David is brilliant, he's an idea machine, and he's compassionate. Sal, he's innovative and revolutionary. So get ready, because here comes Sal Khan.
Very exciting to be here. I always like to start getting a sense of how familiar y'all might be with Khan Academy. How many of you know of it or use it? And how many of you are unfamiliar with it? Okay, that's why we're here. No, we can. So those of you who know Khan Academy, we're often associated with a collection of videos that I first made for my cousins. It's not much more than me. We'll see, Khan Academy is much more than just videos. But to get everyone on the same page, I'll show this montage.
All of these interactions are just due to gravity.
This is an age right after Isaac Newton.
I'm told the humidity makes it feel hotter. Why is this?
Excellent question, LeBron.
And you can just see the pleasure he had.
Can you determine which light bulb is being switched?
Things actually can interbreed, although for these two in particular, it seems like the mechanics would get kind of difficult.
I can keep playing around with these numbers and see what kind of colors I can come up with.
If this does not blow your mind, then you have no emotion.
I'm glad you're like Euler's identity. I met a lot of math teachers earlier. As I mentioned, we're much more than just videos. I was meeting a lot of y'all this morning. I think a lot of y'all already use our missions, where students or adults of any, or learners of any age can pick their grade level, learn at their own pace. There's game mechanics, as much practice, as much feedback as they might need to really master the concepts in a given subject area. Just a snapshot of where Khan Academy is now. There's almost 2 million educators using Khan Academy in some way with their classroom. 43 million registered students. And before I talk more about where it is now and where it's going, I'll give a little bit of background. Some of it, I think some of y'all are familiar, because Khan Academy's had very humble beginnings. As was introduced in 2004, I was an analyst at a hedge fund tutoring cousins. I was in Boston. They were in Louisiana, which is where I was born and raised. I actually met many folks from Louisiana earlier this morning. Very exciting. Yeah, there you go. And it was my cousin Nadia. She was 12, and you know, she was having trouble with unit conversion, but slowly but surely, kind of this one-on-one over the phone and the internet tutoring started to pay off. She got caught up with her class and ahead of her class. Then I started tutoring her younger brothers. Then word got around the family that free tutoring was going on. And this is about a year after I started tutoring Nadia, and I found myself tutoring about 10 or 15 cousins. Every day after work, I still had my day job at the hedge fund. And I started writing software for them because I saw they all had gaps in their knowledge. And I was showing this to a friend of mine at a dinner party, and he said, well, the software is cool, Sal, but how are you scaling up your actual lessons? And I said, well, it's hard to do what 15 that I used to do with one cousin. And he said, well, why don't you record some of your lessons as videos and upload them onto YouTube so your cousins can access them? And I immediately said, no. YouTube is for cats playing piano. It is not for serious mathematics. But I got over the idea that it wasn't my idea, and I decided to give it a shot. And you know, I started making videos on a lot of those core concepts that I saw my cousins were having trouble with, adding fractions, unlike denominators, exponents, basic algebra. And I started telling them, why don't you watch this, and then when we get on the phone, we can dig a little bit deeper. And after about a month, I asked them for feedback, and they famously said that they liked me better on YouTube than in person. And it sounds counterintuitive, but it makes a lot of sense, because here there was no judgment. If you were a ninth grade and you had to review your decimals, you didn't have to feel any shame about it. If you were in high school and you had to review your exponents, there was no shame. If you're doing your problem set in the middle of the night, it was always there for you. And so taking that as positive feedback, I kept going, uploading them onto YouTube. They just happened to be public, and it soon became clear that people who are not my cousins were watching. And comments started to come in. You know, some of those early comments were just simple thank yous. Even that I thought was a pretty big deal. I don't know how much time you spend on YouTube. Most of the comments are not thank you. Yeah. But then they got more intense. I got comments, you know, this is the reason I was able to pass my algebra class. This is the reason why after leaving the military I was able to go back to college. I remember in those early days, this was 2007 now, I brought my wife over to read this note I got over YouTube, and it said it was from a mother saying that both of her sons had a learning disability and that these videos were the only way that they were keeping up with their class. And because of that, her and her entire family were praying for me and my entire family every night. And you got to imagine how strange that felt for me. You got to remember, I was working at a hedge fund. I was not used to people praying for me, at least in that way. But then you fast forward to 2009, by that point there was about 50,000 people who were using Khan Academy on a monthly basis. And I sat down with my wife, this is what I woke up in the morning thinking about. And it felt like this could be an institution. And so I set it up as a not-for-profit. And you know, we had a down payment for our house. Said, okay, let's dig into that a little bit and see if we can really get it off the ground. And so this is fall of 2009, I quit my day job. Sure that someone would fund this, because the social return on investment as a not-for-profit felt like it was unlimited. And I whenever you do anything like this, you kind of have to start with a delusional optimism, whether you're entrepreneurial from a for-profit or a not-for-profit point of view. And what you quickly realize is that the world doesn't necessarily come to you as quickly as you hope. About 9 months in, we were digging into our savings, about $5,000 a month. Our first child had just been born. It was frankly just very, very stressful. What had I done? I'd given up a fairly good job. I was getting a few hundred dollars of donations from people donating $5, $10. If it was any of you, thank you. But it was a tough time. And then all of a sudden in May 2010, we get a $10,000 donation. And it was from Ann Doerr. And I immediately emailed her and said, thank you so much for this incredibly generous donation. It's the largest donation Khan Academy has ever received. If we were a physical school, you would not have a building named after you. And Ann, when she got that, she wanted to meet. And when we met over lunch, she said, well, you know, what's your goal here? And I said, well, our mission as a not-for-profit is to provide a free world-class education for anyone, anywhere. And she said, well, that's ambitious. And I said, well, no, it's a mission statement. We don't plan on just being able to check it off this weekend and then move on to healthcare or something. But I showed her the view count. I showed her the software. I showed her how I wanted to internationalize it. And she said, well, you've made a surprising amount of progress. I only have one question. How are you supporting yourself? And in as proud of a way as possible, I said, I'm not. And so she processes that. We part ways. About 10 minutes later, I'm driving into my driveway, and I get a text message from Ann, and it says, you really need to be supporting yourself. I've just wired you $100,000. So that was a good day. And then, frankly, that was the beginning of a cascade of crazier and crazier positive events. A month later, I was running a summer camp. By this point, I was living in Northern California with middle school students. I don't view Khan Academy as a replacement for a classroom. I view it as something that can augment and free up the classroom. And I was running a simulation with these middle school students. And in the midst of that simulation, I started getting text messages from Ann, which you can imagine I now take very seriously. And they were hard to read, but they essentially said, I'm at the Aspen Idea Festival in Aspen, Colorado, Bill Gates on stage, last 5 minutes talking about Khan Academy. So I didn't know what to make of this. I immediately boot the nearest seventh grader off of a computer, and I start looking for some evidence of this event. And after a few minutes, I was able to find it, and this is what I saw.
There's a new website that I've just been using with my kids recently called Khan Academy, K-H-A-N. Just one guy doing some unbelievable 15-minute tutorials. My favorite vignette is that guy, Salman Khan. He was a hedge fund guy making lots of money, and he quit to do these little web videos. And so we've moved, I'd say, about 160 IQ points from the hedge fund category into the teaching many, many people in the leveraged way category. So, you know, that was a good day. The day that his wife let him quit his job.
So you couldn't imagine what was going on in my head. I actually was nervous. Those videos were for Nadia, not Bill Gates. Then that night, I remember, you know, having dinner with my wife, and I was like, you know, what do I do now? Do I call him? I'm assuming he's not listed. And they left me in that state for about 2 weeks. 2 weeks later, I'm in Khan Academy's headquarters at the time, my walk-in closet, about to record a video, and all of a sudden my cell phone rings. I see it's a Seattle number. I answer it. Hello? Hi, this is Larry Cohen. I'm Bill Gates' chief of staff. You might have heard that Bill's a fan. Yeah, I heard that. And if you're free over the next few weeks, we'd love to fly you up to Seattle and learn more about what you're doing. And I was looking at my calendar for the month, completely blank. I said, yeah, I got to cut my nails, do some laundry, but I think I can meet Bill Gates. And we had that meeting, and it was eerily similar to the meeting with Ann. What's your mission? What would you do with more resources? At around the same time, some folks from Google reached out, asked the same type of questions. And so it all came together in fall of 2010. We were able to become with their funding and now many others, we were able to become a real not-for-profit, get office space, et cetera. And what we immediately started working on, I kept making videos, but we started really investing in the software part of Khan Academy that I hear a lot of y'all are familiar with. And I show this knowledge map because it shows how we think of a mastery progression through a subject like mathematics. Each of those circles there is a concept. The ones at the very top are the things you might learn in kindergarten or should learn in kindergarten, basic addition, basic subtraction. And as you show mastery, you'll get as many items as you need with feedback. But as the system says, okay, looks like so-and-so gets it, it'll move the student to the next concept. It might be more advanced addition or a more advanced subtraction. It keeps going all the way down. There's today 800 skills on there that go all the way to college level calculus and statistics. And on some level, this seems like common sense. This is the way you would play a video game. You keep working on level one, and when you beat level one, you go on to level two. It's the way you would learn a martial art. You keep working on your white belt skills, and only when you've mastered it, you go on to yellow belt. But what we point out, this is not the way that a traditional academic model is structured. The one we all grew up in, a lot of us work in. Traditional model, you are all moved together, usually, or grouped together by age, and then moved at the same pace. And what typically happens is you'll go to class. Let's say we're in a middle school pre-algebra class, the units on exponents. We'll get a lecture on it. We'll go home, do some homework, review the homework the next day, get another lecture homework. That'll continue for about 2 or 3 weeks, and then we get a test. And on that test, maybe I get a 70%, you get an 80%, you get a 95%. Even though that test identified gaps, I didn't know 30% of the material that happened to be on that test. Even that A student, what was that 5% that she didn't know? It might have been a careless error, or it might have been something really important. What happens when you raise something to the zeroth power? Even though it identifies those gaps, it moves on, it just kind of does nothing about it, and then moves on to the next concept. Probably a concept that's going to build on those gaps. It might be negative exponents or logarithms. And that process keeps continuing all the way until, where you keep accumulating a 5% deficit there, 20% deficit there, 30% deficit, all the way that all of a sudden you're in algebra class and nothing makes sense. And it's not because algebra is difficult or because you're not bright. It's because there's an equation that has a zero in the exponent, and you forgot, you never really learned that properly. And to appreciate how absurd that is on some level, imagine if we did other things in our life that way. Say home building. So we bring the contractor in, and we say, okay, we have 3 weeks to build the foundation, do what you can. So they do what they can. 3 weeks later, the inspector comes, and maybe it rained, and he says, okay, that's still wet over there, that's not up to code, I'll give it an 80%. You say, great, that's a C, let's build the first floor. Same thing, 2 weeks, do what you can. And, maybe it's a 70%. Great, let's build the third floor. And while you're building the third floor, the whole structure collapses. And for the reactions we typically have, it's like, oh, maybe we needed a better contractor or more inspection. But the real issue is we were artificially constraining how long we had to do something, ensuring a variable outcome. And so the model that we're saying is, no, do it the other way around. Have a variable time when and how long a student works on something and ensuring that they get to a level of mastery. Instead of the variable outcome of A, B, C, D, F, every student should get to that A level. And to get a sense of, just how much potential there is if we let people learn that way, I'll show you this next video. Oh, actually, well, before I go into the video, this is data that we had from where we did a survey at Stanford initially and then other selective universities, and we said, has Khan Academy had a meaningful impact on your education? And we were hoping that 5 or 10% would say yes. It turned out that 60% of the students said yes, and that the subset that were the first in their family to go to college, 64% said yes. And the types of things that they said were, this was the private tutor that my family couldn't afford, the only way that I was able to access AP classes or have the level of rigor that I needed to prepare for the AP or for a college like Stanford. What we've also seen is of the students who do the work on Khan Academy, once again, not just the videos, but the exercises, and they complete at least 60% of their of kind of a grade level work on Khan Academy, they've had 1.8 times the level of learning in that time period that you would expect. And this was a study with 10,500 students in the state of Idaho. And this is the...
So I actually dropped out of high school twice, both during my freshman year. And when I eventually came back, I was put in sort of lower level math and science classes because I was so behind. Then I discovered Khan Academy, and I was able to skip 2 years worth of math just through using the site. And I came into school, I took the exam with students who had been enrolled in the class all year, and I was actually able to get the highest or the second highest scores in the class. So for me, Khan Academy really changed the trajectory of my entire life. Because without it, I don't think I ever really would have been inspired to learn and to love math and to love science. I ended up graduating as a valedictorian and going on to Princeton, where I'm now a computer science major, and I'm absolutely passionate about learning, about computers, about math, about science. And without Khan Academy, I don't think that these things would really matter to me the way that they do today.
So, there's a fun epilogue. Since we got that testimonial 2 years later, Charlie has just joined as a full-time employee. So in a very strange way, we're helping to solve our own labor problems. So everything I've talked about so far is the world that most of us live in, the English-speaking world, the developed world. You might be wondering, what about the rest of the planet? All of these are pictures of Khan Academy being used throughout the world. Probably the most exciting story is the one in the top right. About 2 years ago, I got a testimonial similar to the one from Charlie, from the young woman up in the top right. Her name is Zaya. And she talked about how she liked Khan Academy. And I assume she must be middle class or upper middle class. Her English was quite good. She had access to the internet. But it turned out there was a group of volunteers from Silicon Valley who were going out to Mongolia and setting up computer labs with broadband in orphanages. And Zaya was one of those orphans, and that's a picture of the orphan girls using Khan Academy. And similar to Charlie, what's especially cool is now Zaya, who's graduated, who's I believe 19 or 20 years old today, she is now one of our top contributors of content to Khan Academy in the Mongolian language. So it just shows if you allow people to tap into their potential, what they can do, it may be in a short amount of time. These are just some snapshots of the Khan Academy portal in other languages. And once again, it's not just the videos translated, it's the teacher tools, the dashboards, the software, everything. And to get a feel of what it looks like in other languages or sounds like, I'll show you this.
Me comí dos cuartos de pizza.
L'hypoténuse commune, ok.
Si, 13, 15.
Or mes hattes block ko dhakelne ki koshish kar raha hu is direction mein.
Tujad qit'atayn min nadin nihas wa zinc.
Pi or be tawan do zarb dare.
Ki ani kuda sheba shok asiyum shel azafit khotekhet et ma'gal hayichida.
Ili mweze kwelewa na kweza.
Into qala kufuna ka siyazi kukuba kubani.
16 bele 16 bir eşittir.
Muitas e muitas e muitas outras coisas importantes.
I'm Isaiah from Mongolia. We just are so interesting and funny, make more lessons.
So there should be a few more pictures that show up right after that. So here's here's some more pictures of Khan Academy being used throughout the world. And you know, when we look at this, and Khan Academy is much more than just me now. We're over 100 full-time employees. We have volunteers around the world who are helping to make this happen. Many of y'all in the audience are using it in your classrooms. And what I point out to everyone, I like to give a thought experiment of kind of just where we are in history and the opportunity. Imagine going back in time 400 years to Western Europe, which even then was one of the more educated parts of the planet. You would have seen about 15% of the population knew how to read, about 20% of men and about 10% of women. And I suspect that if you went to someone who knew how to read, say a member of the clergy, and you said, what percentage of the population do you think is even capable of reading if you had a perfect education system? They might have said, well, maybe with a perfect education system, 40, 50% is even capable of reading. Well, today, fast forward 400 years, we know that that would have been a wildly pessimistic prediction, that pretty close to 100% of the population is capable of reading. But if I were to ask you a similar question today, what percentage of the population do you think is capable of being an entrepreneur, is capable of contributing to cancer research, is capable of understanding quantum physics or calculus? I think a lot of y'all might say, well, you know, maybe 5, 10%, maybe with a great education system it's 20%. But what if that's just based on our experience in a non-mastery system, where ourselves and our peers, we would go through pre-algebra, get a gap here, get a gap there, algebra, gap there, and then all of a sudden, when we get to the physics class, nothing makes sense. And we say, okay, only about 5% is able to get it, but that's the 5% who's lucky enough to have not too many gaps. What if we're able to allow every student to learn at their own pace, fill in those gaps? Maybe that number could be a lot higher. Maybe it could be 40 or 50% is capable of contributing to research or discovering new drugs, curing diseases. Maybe it's 70 or 80%. I actually think it's on the higher end of that. And if we do that, it actually addresses a major social issue that we're facing, because we're transitioning from an industrial economy to an information economy. The industrial economy was a pyramid. You needed a lot of labor in the factories. You needed kind of this middle bureaucratic information processing class. And at the top, you had the kind of the creative class, the researchers, the doctors, the entrepreneurs. But what we know what's happening. Robotics are going to collapse. First globalization, then robotics are going to collapse that bottom where human physical labor isn't going to be as needed. Even the information processing, that's what computers do. And so we face a social question. We're going to have all this increased productivity because of technology, but does it just go to a small top of the pyramid, and then what does everyone else do? Do we have an unstable society? Do we just redistribute? Or do we do the most optimistic thing, and we invert that pyramid, where we bring as many people as possible, we bring 70, 80% of the population so they can participate in that creative class. So if we do that, I think it's going to be a very, very exciting time to live. Thank you.
Please welcome David Coleman, President and CEO of the College Board.
Good morning. May I say what an honor and blessing it is to be here. I was particularly honored to be introduced by a woman who I consider one of the most remarkable figures in our field, Hanna Skandera. She has led in Florida, she has led in New Mexico. She has dealt with impossible politics with vision and grace, as many of you. Hanna, you're amazing. And if she is one of the best single people I know in the education field, there is no better dynamic duo in the field of education. All I meant was individuals, please. There's no better dynamic duo in the field of education than Patricia Levesque and Governor Jeb Bush. And I've been here over the past 3 days, and I've been listening to you, and I've been thinking about the role you play in your lives and the difficulties you face, where basically no good deed goes unpunished. You're asked to show courage, to protect families and their children, and get attacked from all sides as you do so. And frankly, I think that that should make places like the College Board that I lead think again about what we give you. Like, to put it bluntly, as I come on stage, I bet you're thinking, like, hooray, President of the College Board coming to give me a test, just what I needed. Because frankly, I think what your constituents are saying, and what I believe, is this country doesn't need more tests, it needs more opportunities. So what does that mean for the College Board? We were founded 100 years ago at a moment when a set of colleges feared that privilege rather than merit might rule this country and threaten our democracy. And they had what was then a noble idea to create an exam to open up higher education to merit wherever it would be found. But when I became president of the College Board, roughly 100 years after that, very few people saw the College Board, the SAT, as a symbol of opportunity and openness and fairness. In fact, they saw it as certifying inequities in our society. They saw costly test preparation corrupting the idea of fairness and merit. They saw expensive college advice giving advantages to some kids rather than others. I think if the College Board is to be useful to you and to this country, we must rededicate ourselves to our original mission. We must dedicate ourselves to once again clearing a path for all students to own their future. We have to admit that barriers have arisen that are not right and not fair, that the opportunity chain has been broken. Let me put it to you very simply. In our judgment, assessment without opportunity is dead. We will make no progress. We can give no more tests without delivering opportunities and changing the arc of young people's futures in this country. So what does that mean for the College Board? I've been working in the meeting thinking about what you've been saying on a top 10 list of our actions and agenda. So I will share that with you this morning. First, we must make the SAT more than fair. What do I mean by that? You may have heard we redesigned this controversial little herd of tests called the SAT a couple of years ago. You may know something about it. For example, what is the definition of an SAT word? It is a word you likely have not heard before and likely shall not hear again. Think about what that meant to young people thinking of going to college. Think of the intimidation. The wall between you and college is a set of words you never use, won't likely use. Imagine you're an English language learner. Imagine you're born in a rural, poor environment where people don't talk that way. But in order to go to college, you have to fake it. Not so. SAT words are gone from the exam. The words on the exam are the words you'll use not most rarely, but the words you'll use most often in your first year of college. To put it simply, it was always a dumb idea that you did anything to prepare for the SAT. It's only a good idea to do the work you need to prepare for the first year of college or your career. Everything the exam asks you for must be only those things that are most useful to you. There are only three areas of math on the SAT that are 80% of the test. Which are they? The math you most use in a first year career training course or in the first year of college. Do nothing for the SAT, only what best prepares you for your future. But we've gone further. Did you know there's 43% more time per question on the SAT than the ACT or any other similar test? Why? Yeah, it's good. One of the worst things assessment has done in this country is to confuse quick and smart. Some of the finest minds I know are slower minds to speak, to write, and it's time we honored them and allowed them to do their best work in assessment. We have to make it easier. I know this sounds strange. It is time to make excellence easier. We want the SAT to be the easiest place for students to show their power, to do their best work, to invite all students that they've got a shot. First, make the SAT more than fair. Number two, never give someone one chance to be great. How did we ever think it was okay to suddenly give you an exam at the end of high school and then determine your future? That's why we've redesigned the PSAT as well. And beginning in 8th to 9th grade, and as Hanna said, young people throughout this country now can take a PSAT and know where they're going. They can see their trajectory. They can plan. But we had to change something else. People have long said the PSAT predicts what you will get on the SAT. Have you heard that before? That's what it is, right? Not so. The PSAT does not predict what you'll get on the SAT. In fact, as Governor Bush likes to say, God gives us our potential. And no test can know your potential or say it. That is an unholy thing. All a test can do is invite you to what you could become through practice. The PSAT does no longer predict your SAT score because it has become an invitation to practice. It is no longer a practice test. It invites you into free practice. It invites you to your God-given talent to become all you can become. And that leads to my third principle, make practice free for all. Used to be the College Board looked over at the test prep industry and said, test prep doesn't matter. Do you remember when we said this? How many people believed us? Nobody. And we kind of said it wasn't our fault, right? It's like we made a great test, this kind of corrupting test prep field emerged, not our fault. But my friends, while it may not be our fault, it most certainly is our problem. Because the perception that by buying access, that not merit, but your wealth is what drove success has been a terrible signal to this country. And that's why we partnered with Khan Academy when we designed the exam, and we will forever forward provide the best of test preparation and practice free for the world. You might want to guess how many students have signed up for Khan Academy in the first year we gave the redesigned SAT. I don't have time to guess. I will tell you it is 2.5 million young people. But free, as all of you know, is not necessarily equal. It's a deep point. Free does not mean equal. Why? Because some kids will take advantage of free things, and some we worry most about. Think of what it's like in rural environments, more disconnected, with less information. Are they going to fully take advantage of these resources? I have very good news for you today. We have studied at all levels of income in this country. More students are practicing on Khan Academy than everywhere else, and all races. And you know what we found out? And by the way, there are 5 times more students practicing on Khan Academy than all of commercial test preparation combined. And you know what we found, as all of you know, is many of these students don't have a laptop. Many young people only access the internet over their phone. So we designed an application where you can now print out an SAT for free from us. You get a pencil, you fill it in. You take pictures of your answer sheet with your phone. In 34 seconds, the College Board scores it for free. You are then linked, if you choose to give the data, to your personalized account on Khan Academy. All you need is your phone and a pencil. You may have to buy the pencil, but the rest is free. It is time to make practice free for all. I'll tell you something else kind of beautiful. Practice is an equal opportunity employer. We see kids of every race, every background, growing through practice. Interestingly, African American and Latino kids, slightly more. Low-income kids, slightly more. Students who have been deprived access when getting it surge through practice, through their labor. And practice works. We will unveil to the country in the new year remarkable data, reaffirming an ancient principle, but one worth saying. You can indeed get good at anything if you follow your love and practice. Number 3, make practice free for all. Number 4, fulfill the broken promises of assessment. I honor many of you in this room because you have defended testing and accountability systems. And that's a tough sell on the left and on the right. But you know what? I think we've failed you. Because what is the argument we made for the SAT? We said it finds a diamond in the rough. Have you heard this argument? That you give the SAT because some kid lost in a high school will find them and they'll claim their future. So we looked at the data. We looked at the top 10% of SAT scorers who happen to be poor, who are in the bottom quartile of income in this country. And you know what? 50% of those student athletes, those students who have overcome the visible and visible barriers that poverty creates, they did not apply to a single selective college. They and their families betrayed themselves at the moment the game got important. And you could say it's not our fault, but it is our problem. So we looked into it, and you know what we found? Is that when you don't have the income, if you're low income, you have to apply for a fee waiver to apply to college. So you have to write the admissions officer and say, can I prove to you that I don't have the money so that I can apply to your school? That's encouraging. So we agreed with our member colleges that if we had given a low-income fee waiver for that young person to take the SAT, why not work with them? And what we now do is every young person who takes an SAT then receives in the mail 4 fee waivers with their name on it to apply to college. My favorite day on the job so far is when those emails go out, those packages go out, and a student posted them on Instagram, and he said, the College Board sent me fee waivers because I am awesome. He did not say because he was poor. We have got to stop asking families of limited means to prove over and over again that they are poor for small amounts of money. It should be... We have waived our fees on profile for all low-income students. They automatically, like Easy Pass, flow through our system towards college. Number 5, we must end the war between college and career. For too long, the College Board has offered you too narrow a path for all the young students in your care. We must own the crisis that so many of students in this country do not see themselves as college material, and that feels so distant. What about relating to their much more immediate desires? There's desire to work productively and connecting it. You may not know that one of the biggest forces in redesigning the SAT were employers. We've aligned it not just for college, but the work you need for a career training program. Our AP computer science principals were talking to employers to help them with summer jobs when you get that credential. Give me something back today. We've partnered with Project Lead the Way, so there's now a fused credential of career readiness and college readiness from AP. I'm so glad to announce that every student who takes the PSAT will now also receive a free account from Road Trip Nation to dream up their future, to think at this moment in their life, what might my dreams of my career inspire me to study in school? We must end the war between college and career. Number six, credit is earned, not given away. Nat Malkus of the American Enterprise Institute raised a challenging question. He said, AP is grown by a million students. Have they diluted its rigor? And we think this, right? If something's grown that much, probably they're giving it away. And he wrote, this is the American Enterprise Institute, by the way, a place you guys know pretty well. He said, what might be the single happiest education story of the century, that AP has grown and become diverse without diminishing standards. And we should do more. Within advanced placement, you'll be delighted with what we'll do next to support a wide range of students. But I promise you, we will never help them succeed by giving them credit they have not earned. The passing rate in advanced placement is 58%. In dual credit programs, it is 97%. And I think we have an obligation to be honest with young people and their families, that they must, before college, not be given credit merely, but do the work and demands of college so they won't be leading to debt and no degree, which is not a fair bargain for anybody. Number seven, we must no longer allow economies of scale to neglect rural America. It's easy to see. 2,000 schools immediately signed up for our computer science principles course. But where do they sign up? Where there's enough kids for an AP classroom. And the College Board has tolerated that for too long. It never spreads to the small schools where there aren't enough kids to make an AP classroom. So you know what the reform community then says? And I know you have heard this. We'll beam it in. We'll have a distance learning course. Don't worry about a thing. Do you know the completion rates on online coursework when there isn't a caring adult guiding adolescents through it? Less than 5%. Thanks a lot. So the College Board today makes a new commitment to you. We are a nonprofit organization. Whatever the economics are for us, we will commit over the next few years to get AP Computer Science principles, the clear career opportunity it represents in the new economy, to every single high school in this country with a trained teacher ready to teach that course and help children through it, no matter how few there are. Number eight, education is a soul craft. When we talk about college and career, and I've talked about it, I think we may have forgotten an ancient thing. Education is a precious thing. It involves the life of the soul. My only published op-ed piece is in the National Review, and it is a defense of Wheaton College, the Christian Evangelical College, and its right to thrive. I offered a wager in that piece to the snobbery of higher education, broadly considered, and I said, if secular colleges think that the religious Christian colleges cannot make great students, I'll bet them. Let's compare the growth of similar students at these two types of institutions and see which grow more in critical analysis, mathematics, and literacy. No one has taken me up on that wager. I've spoken to religious educators and homeschoolers across this country about the special gifts religious education offers to education more broadly. Productive solitude, In our time, the technology of interruption has outpaced the technology of concentration. We need to recover ancient things within public education, within religious schooling, within our homes, if we're going to succeed in education. The time for the stupid division between religious education, public education, homeschooling education must end. Nine, knowledge matters in civic education. This may seem uncontroversial, but what civics education has become, which I think is about the soul of our country, is a place where students get engaged in the world. There's student engagement, which means going out, protesting, doing stuff without knowing a lot. I would invite you to instead read something we're very proud of, the new AP Government and Politics course from the College Board. In it, we require that students gain a working knowledge of our Constitution, know it almost by heart. We require that you read 16 Supreme Court opinions. We require that you understand the separation of powers, the liberties granted to each of us as citizens, that you know them. Without such knowledge, civics is a sham. Finally, number 10. We must end the insanity about the admissions process. Now, me saying this to you, the college admissions process, might sound like Darth Vader coming to you about restoring democracy to our republic. Because the College Board has to admit its unproductive role in the unproductive anxiety that harries your children and families throughout this country. I gotta tell you, the scariest days of my job are when parents tell me that their kids are really busy. They're so busy. And it's so sad and so senseless. In my family, we keep the Sabbath holy. I'll just say one thing. Right now in the Common Application for College, there are 12 boxes for your activities beyond your schoolwork. I say, why not three? Why not just ask students three things that they're devoted to, not 12? And if they want to do more, God bless them, but not to get into college. We need to make more time for faith, for family, for fun. We need to restore adolescence. I'm taking too long, so I'll speed up. There's a principle that rules all of these, which is that parents and families must come first. I just want to be candid about the College Board. I worry we have in the past had more hostages than clients. Parents who felt they had to pay our fees because they had to, and it's time to become a friend and an ally in their journey. We've redesigned every report we do. We've redesigned all our work. I'm so proud of what we're doing for military families in this country. Do you know now when you take the PSAT, you can let it be known that you're a military young person, so even if you move and even if your life changes, scholarship organizations can find you. We're doing that this fall. But when you talk about putting parents and families first, let's talk about students who I hope are no longer hostages than our clients. We want to end by showing you the product of Sol Khan and my work, some of the athletes who are taking full advantage of Khan Academy. Aviana Johnson, a senior at East Bay High School in Gadsden, Florida, would you please come on stage with me? And Camigo Teagle Alarcon, will you please come up with me as well? Okay. So here's what everyone wants to know. You took the PSAT, correct?
Yes.
Both of you. Okay. So you practiced on Khan Academy. How much did you improve between your PSAT and your SAT?
I improved over 200 points, I believe so.
How about you, Kuna?
I improved about 200 points the first time and then another 100 points for the second time I took it.
How'd you do it? How'd you do it? What's your secret? Come on, everyone here is wondering. You gotta tell them.
Well, from, I studied at school, thanks to my teacher, Ms. Adams. I studied at home. My goal was to get out of reading class because that's a graduation requirement to get out of reading. So I always focused on the reading portion. And I had the reading class, so we used College Board and we used Khan Academy for the reading. So that's how I got it.
How about you, Camilla? What's your secret? What'd you do?
Just practice makes perfect.
Yeah. It's a great secret to have, isn't it? What would you both have done without Khan Academy? What'd you have before there were these free resources on Khan Academy?
Packets. Just packets of reading assignments. Just packets.
Yeah. Packets and books, probably. The Princeton Review and Kaplan, probably.
Yeah. Aviana, you're on your flag football team.
Yes.
Tell me what it's like as an athlete. How do you see the work of Khan Academy and your life being an athlete as well?
Well, honestly, it's kind of hard juggling a sport that lasts the whole day and school that lasts the whole day. But I got the opportunity to do it at home. So I'd go from school to practice, and then home and study.
Camila, tell me how it fits into your life.
Well, especially since I play water polo during tournaments, since it's on the application, on like my phone application, I was really able to just like pull it out whenever like we were waiting, and that really helped just like to get my mind on it.
So 200, 300 points, who cares? How has it changed your life, your growth? What about your future?
Well, it changed me to be a better person. From how I was from freshman year to now, I've said I've matured, and now I'm kind of more focused on my future. I want to become successful, and I'm like right there. But my goal is to go all the way up.
It was kind of like a stress reliever when I like finished taking the test. Because now it's just one other step I have to like reach my goal in the future. So.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? It's not just about, I think of sometimes test prep prepares you for one thing, a test, but practice prepares you for everything.
Yes.
And I think if you look out at this audience, they are so excited about what you will do next. Congratulations and God bless you. We're tight on time, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna invite Sal and Hanna to come up together. Thank you so much, both of you. You can return to the audience.
Thank you.
And I just wanted to invite either Sal or Hanna for any concluding remarks. And I don't know how much time, if we'll have any for questions. So I think maybe we'll stand afterwards. Okay, terrific. Oh, terrific. So we will have time for questions. Thanks.
So we don't have to call you a hog or Sal a hog. We have more time.
But you still got to.
Well, just to kick off some question and answer time, we'll kick it over to the audience in just a minute, so get ready. I started the introduction of both of you by saying, or at the tail end of the introduction, you're brilliant, you're an idea machine, you're compassionate, you're innovative, and you're revolutionary. And I feel like I know that, but I think the audience knows that now. So thank you. Very much. Because we're short on time, we're going to just pass over the softball questions that most folks get and move straight to the real stuff. As you look ahead over the next 5 to 10 years, Khan Academy, College Board, what changes? You just put out a vision, 10 incredible, not just a vision, sets of change, and it's a paradigm shift. What does that look like 5 years down the road? You also put out a vision that's being realized right now. My best moment as you were speaking was I was thinking, yeah, school's kind of like Pac-Man. I get to go to the next level as soon as I eat that thing. Where are we going?
Please help us, sir.
Yeah, you know, what's really exciting, especially a lot about the College Board partnership, you know, part of the vision has always been if you're in a part of the world where you don't have access to a school that you could self-educate and then one day prove what you know and have access to career or college. But ideally, you do have access to a classroom and that Khan Academy could supercharge it and also still have access to career in college. And this partnership with the College Board has formalized it in a way that, you know, is surprising both David and myself every day. You know, I believe it was David's idea where it was just like, hey, we have this PSAT in 10th grade. Why don't we sync that with Khan Academy? And now the PSAT, to David's words, as opposed to being just a pretest, it's a gateway to opportunity. So you get your score. It's not like, oh, this is your score, this is where you are. It says go to Khan Academy, sync your account. So when it syncs your account, it acts as a diagnostic for Khan Academy. So all those gaps that I was talking about, the PSAT is now used to identify those gaps. The software on Khan Academy knows those gaps now, not just in math, but in reading and writing as well. And they can start doing weak point training with you over the next few years. And what's really powerful is that we can start to do things in education that we can never do before, where you have the PSAT, we see the work you do on Khan Academy on a daily basis, and then we see the SAT. And so we can have this longitudinal study of what work on Khan Academy actually correlates with outcomes on the SAT and on college readiness. And you can imagine it becomes even more powerful as we start thinking about things like the PSAT-8. So that's very exciting. What David talked about these pathways to both college and career, that's close to our vision. So I think, you know, this is both organizations together. It's everyone in the room. I think it's going to be a very exciting time where we can do these things that would have seemed like science fiction 10 years ago.
You know, Hanna, you asked to play hardball, so I'll be tough too. I think in your position as political leaders and social leaders, you cannot defend the indefensible. And I think sometimes we've asked you to do that. And I think the pressure on exams that do not offer families specific benefits and opportunity will wash them away, whatever your good efforts. I think, you know, it's interesting, when we partnered with Khan Academy, other competitors, you know, players in the assessment industry kind of got a little anxious that this might be a good thing. And so one responded, for example, by offering some sort of test prep for low-income kids, but then everyone else pays for it. And I thought to myself, oh, they do not get it. They do not begin to understand the accumulated rage of the working class and middle class in this country who is so darn tired of being charged for things that they should have as a natural part of being citizens of this country, as part of being on their way to college. And I think the politics of the future, while we of course, and you heard me many times, should do more for the poor, has to be far more inclusive. We have to think about the middle class, the working class, the barriers they face. And in everything the College Board's doing, we're trying to take a broader view. And I think that says saying goodbye to certain kinds of practices we've been comfortable with for a long time to seek a broader future.
You both alluded to, talked about competency-based learning. So talk about the pros and the cons and really more the potential pitfalls that we should be looking ahead and making sure we're getting ahead of those potential pitfalls. I don't think there's many folks who would say we shouldn't get to the competency piece, but what are some of the things we need to be thinking about?
Sal, can I start on that one? Because I feel this acutely. I think it can sometimes be too cute to say each kid has their own journey and can do whatever they want. Because you know what? When it comes time for an athletic competition or a job or getting into college, the world is not so forgiving of what color is your parachute. What I mean to say is that we should have shared challenges and be open and honest with young people, but practice should be personal. The way you get there, the time you have to get there. Everything should be flexible and responsive to you, but we must admit and be honest with each other that there are shared powerful challenges that are important for students to face. And let's not let the competency-based movement make the mistake of letting all kids go in their own direction when some of those directions don't lead anywhere at all.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I think the key is by having these competency benchmarks and everything I talked about mastery-based learning, and mastery-based learning and competency-based learning go hand in hand, it allows you know, what happens a lot of times, students are in a high school, they think they're doing well, it's kind of a seat time based model, they're promoted with a C, a B, even an A, it's a diluted curriculum sometimes, and then all of a sudden they get to college, and at that point the competency might set in, or maybe the college curriculum is diluted, and then when they go to the workforce, the competence sets in. So if you allow those kind of benchmarks and milestones to happen earlier, then all of a sudden it's a lot better for the student. You know, we started a little lab school under our offices, and one of the things we've experimented with, and it's working out really well, is we've separated out the dimensions of academic competence and social independence. And by doing that, you don't have to face this weird, Jimmy's having trouble in algebra, but he's already 16, so let's put him into the next. Here, if you make them orthogonal, then you can do both. You can say, okay, this is independence level. He's independent, but he still needs to remediate some of his fourth grade level math. So I think a competency is key for things like mastery-based learning.
Great. One more question for both of you, and then we'll turn it over to the audience. What do you see as, how do we bridge, if you will, and maybe there isn't a bridge, it's a jump, and I'd love to hear both of you, is it a bridge, are there incremental steps, or is it a leap, or a little bit of both, as we talk about our traditional public education setting today and where we're going in the future?
Yeah, you know, the interesting thing is we already have a little bit of a competency-based system. You know, when I started working on Khan Academy, I was like, don't we already have, we have AP tests, and I think the issue is for more people to just appreciate it. You know, the reason why we do need things like APs and SATs is because an A or a B in one class versus another, it's very hard to gauge that. So I think the more that we can create a scaffold, an architecture where students can prove their competency, you know, this PSAT 8, PSAT 10, SAT starts, and then AP, that's actually a very powerful competency architecture. And then if Khan Academy can provide the resources and tools for the students and the teachers to work within that architecture, then I think and both organizations can understand what interventions and forms of practice are working and which ones aren't, then I think we have a really neat system going on.
You know, I think it's funny that when education reformers really get excited, they begin to sound like terrorists. We should blow the system up, you know? We've got to get to the next place. I think that the greatness in education is always going to be about holding those ancient things that remain true in the face of the new. So like when I hear 21st century skills, forgive me, I smile because I studied ancient Greece and they were highly creative. And the ancient Romans had global awareness. So these are not new things. It still matters to be able to be alone productively, whether it's for prayer or to read or write well. It matters to turn off technology sometimes, to concentrate. Those things have not changed. And I think it's so important. A teacher with a classroom of children is not just an archaic agrarian thing. It's a beautiful thing when a group of people gather together to read together or solve a problem together. We must not mock these things lightly. But at the same time, where they have clearly gotten in the way, then we must be daring. We must say, why isn't there time for each kid to practice? Why have we crowded that out? Why are kids audience members rather than participants? How can we get to adolescence and make a new deal with them? I think the conversation with families and young people needs to change radically, as much as the structures do.
Great. All right, we've got a few minutes to go to the audience. And we've got mics, I think, as we speak. Great. Where are we? Questions? Number two.
Thank you. Oh, you hold up. Sorry. You take it away with me too. Thank you very much, and thank you for what both of you are doing and the collaboration. My question is, Sal Khan, you started a little bit later in life, so you've got students now who are in high school who have all of those gaps in foundation. How can you take a student who's figured out workarounds, basically accommodating their gaps, and have them go back and build that foundation of a competency that they may be years past now through workarounds?
Yeah, whenever I meet a young person, and even, you know, I have new cousins coming through the pipeline all the time, now nieces and nephews, regardless of where they're starting, even if they're in high school or even if they're adults and they want to go back to college, I tell them start at the early learning mission on Khan Academy, which essentially, and look, if you know all the material, it'll take you half an hour to finish it. But if you don't know the material, well, it should take you a little bit longer. But then go all the way and fill in every gap if you have the time. That's the ideal. And it people will be surprised. You know, 20, 30 minutes a day in 4 or 5 months, a lot of those gaps get to be filled in. Because the more you fill in, the easier it is to fill in the other gaps. if students have less time, if it's, you know, they have something coming up in a few weeks, you know, the SAT prep is actually what we're doing on Khan Academy, because, you know, both David and I agreed it shouldn't be traditional prep of just like, oh, when in doubt, guess C, or this is how you rule out answers. It should be, oh, if you don't know this material, here's the actual material. And so I think in a shorter period of time, if a student has 2-3 months down to a week, even if it's not for the SAT, it's really about getting college ready. I think that's an excellent tool.
Yeah, just a word, you know, we're thinking a lot about adult learners or people who may have not made the first time getting ready for college, that they're not damned to perdition, that they deserve other opportunities, or if they're a veteran coming home. We have a program called CLEP, where you can take the college credit you've earned at any moment. We're thinking of course, working with Khan Academy. I just want to be candid, though, about something. We are largely helpless to achieve these ambitious things I'm saying without the people in this room. It was Hanna Skandera who led an effort in New Mexico to get kids signed up on Khan Academy. We can make these things available. We're working with churches. We're working with nonprofit partners. But we need your help as spokespeople to engage people in this work. The motivational crisis is real, and we really need your help doing that kind of thing.
Number one. Okay. Hi, I'm State Representative Valencia Stovall from the state of Georgia. And I would like to know, what is the expected timeline from all the work that the College Board is doing with Khan Academy on really being able to see the effect that the two merging together, we'll really be able to see the effect of it. For example, I have a nephew that recently took the SAT, and now he's going through that whole process of trying to figure out what school, what to do and all of that. So I would like to also compliment you all for being able to make it easier for our students, but I just kind of want to know what the timeline, expected timeline for results.
How about let's talk after this conversation about your son? I'll do all I can to help with that. But I'll say this. We find that in as few as 10 hours, when students gain a working familiarity with the exam, they gain a substantial amount. I'm not allowed to disclose these results in a too detailed way to the public, but since you've asked for candor, I'll give it to you. There's a first phase, which is test familiarity. But then you see these student athletes you saw before you. They've decided to devote an hour a day, sometimes 3 times a week, because to transform yourself in mathematics is a devotion. So for your son, you know, let's talk, but beginning with mathematics, letting himself be enthralled and kept up at night and throwing himself into this, I can certify to you, with backing of research, that he can change his outcomes substantially.
Number five.
That starts today, by the way, if he has time.
Hi, my name is Sherelle Swain. I'm from Friends of Choice in Urban Schools here in Washington, D.C. I've used Khan Academy a lot in my classroom at Youth Build Public Charter School when I was a school teacher, and saw amazing results with the students, so I'd like to thank you for that. My question is around, there was a statistic you mentioned earlier that less than 5% of students are able to successfully progress if they don't have the support of a classroom teacher when using an online learning program. And I was wondering about any training or opportunities for teachers to learn how to integrate this free and very useful software into their classroom to take full advantage. Thank you.
Yeah, appreciate that question. Now, that's something that we're trying to figure out. We have our entire team at Khan Academy is about 100 folks, and so we have a relatively small team of about 10 people who are focused on that. And our goal, and to David's earlier point, is we need your help. We need to figure out a way, you know, to, when my friend told me, how do I scale the lessons? I think we're trying to figure out, how do we scale? We have an ambassador program of teachers who are super users of Khan Academy who can teach in their community, but we'd love to explore with all of y'all how we can create these pockets of best practice that can then spread in each of your regions.
And please do hear me, a caring adult. While the classroom teacher matters, it can be a coach or a parent, maybe even someone who's not an expert, but who scaffolds the young person engaging themselves. We're working with the Boys and Girls Clubs. We're working with every civic institution, with churches, but also, of course, with teachers. And in every district and state that we're partnered with, because it is free for everyone, enlightened superintendents are making time for us to work it into the training of school teachers, work it into the classroom.
Unfortunately, we are out of time, so please join me in thanking both Sal and David.